نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم حاميم والكتاب المبين إنا جعلناه قرآنا عربيا لعلكم تعقلون وإنه في أم الكتاب لدينا لعلي حكيم وقال تبارك وتعالى كما ورد في سورة الواقعة إنه لقرآن كريم في كتاب مكنون لا يمسه إلا المطهرون تنزيل من رب العالمين وقال عز وجل كما ورد في سورة القيامة لا تحرك به لسانك لتعجل به إن علينا جمعه وقرآنه فإذا قرأناه فاتبع قرآنه ثم إن علينا بيانه صدق الله العظيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي اللهم ربنا ألهمنا رشدنا وأعذنا من شرور أنفسنا اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى آمین یا رب العالمین. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. With the name of Allah and invoking His blessings and help, we are starting our month-long program of a rapid translation of the whole of the Quran and a brief explanation along with. As I told you couple of days before in my Sunday lecture or this place, we shall be holding inshallah 4 sessions of 1 hour each every night. For today, the first hour I'm taking, I'll try in half an hour to finish with some introduction, some basic and fundamental facts and figures about Quran-e-Hakim, and then about half an hour for Suratul Fatiha. And then in the second hour, inshallah, we shall start with Suratul Baqarah. About Quran, first of all, we all believe that Quran is the word of Allah. Al-Quranu Kalamullah is the speech of Allah, word of Allah, and it is protected and preserved. Its protection and preservation is guaranteed by Allah Himself. Number two, the real and original Quran is with Allah. What we have in our hands is, so to say, an attested copy of that real Quran. That real Quran is in Lawh-e Mahfuz. بَلْ هُوَ قُرْآنٌ مَجِيدٌ فِي لَوْحِ مَحْفُوظٍ. At another place, as I have recited the ayat from Suratul Waqiyah, fi kitabim maknoon, the hidden book. This is Quran Kareem, and it is in the hidden book. Fi kitabim maknoon, la yamassuhu illa al-mutahharoon. And from there it was sent down to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So actually the real Quran is there. That is why I have recited the first 4 ayat of Suratul Zukhruf. حَامِيمْ وَالْكِتَابِ الْمُبِينِ. By this book, which is very clear, it is expressive of all its meanings. إِنَّا جَعَلْنَاهُ قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. And we have made it a Quran in Arabic language so that you can understand. And here actually the addressees are the Arabs, who were the first addressees of Quran. I'll discuss this point later on, inshallah. وَإِنَّهُ فِي أُمِّ الْكِتَابِ لَدَيْنَا لَعَلِيُّ الْحَكِيمِ. And this Quran is in the mother of the books, أُمِّ الْكِتَابِ, the real mother book, لَدَيْنَا, it is with us, الْعَلِيُّ الْحَكِيمِ. And this book is exalted and full of wisdom. So the real Quran is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فِي لَوْحِ مَحْفُوظٍ فِي كِتَابٍ مَكْنُونٍ فِي أُمِّ الْكِتَابِ لَدَيْنَا. And these are actually the attested copies of the Quran that is in Lauh-e Mahfuz. From there, it was sent down. And this coming down of the Quran was in two stages. Number one, in one night, round about the year 610 of the Christian era, one night of the month of Ramadan, that is Laylatul Qadr, the whole of the Quran, from the Lauh-e Mahfuz and from the Ummul Kitab, as I've told you, it was sent down to the first heaven. Actually, the lowest heaven from the divine side. But from our side, it's the first heaven. The whole of this Quran was sent in that night, Laylatul Qadr. Inna anzalnahu fi Laylatul Qadr. Wa ma adraka ma Laylatul Qadr. Laylatul Qadr khairun min alfi shahr. تنزل الملائكة والروح فيها بإذن ربهم من كل أمر سلام هي حتى مطلع الفجر. And this Laylatul Qadr was in the month of Ramadan. That is why we have just listened in the prayer also, in the first rakat of Surah of Salatul Isha. This شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان. For this first coming down of the Quran, the verb that is used in Quran is anzalna. Anzala yunzilu inzalan. Because this means one piece, suddenly sending down something at one time, one piece. So the whole of the Quran was sent down from that Lauh-e Mahfuz, from that Kitabun Maknoon, from that Ummul Kitab to the first heaven. Now that is second stage was that from there it was sent down to the heart of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam through Archangel Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. And it was bit by bit, ayah by ayah, surah by surah. And it took 22 long years in the complete revelation of the Quran to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And who was Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? We all believe he was the last prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But here I want to mention, he was from the progeny of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam through Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam. And you know that his tribe Quraysh, that belonged to the progeny of Ibrahim and Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam. And they were settled, you know, being Ummul Qura, that is Makkah al-Mukarramah. So there actually, that is the place where Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam was born in the year 571 of Christian era. And when he was round about 40 years, this revelation started to him in Ghar-e Hira, in the cave of Hira. And that was the year 610, as far as we can assess and we can know. Now, during these 22 years of the revelation of Quran, for about 12 years, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stayed at Makkah. So the amount of Quran that was revealed during this period is called the Makki Quran, the surahs, Makki surahs, and it is round about 2/3 of the whole of the Quran. Then he migrated in the year 622 to Madinah Munawwara, and from thence till his death in 632, that is 10 years, he stayed at Madinah. But during these 10 years, he was making journeys for battles also, for you know, Battle of Badr. Then he had to go even to Tabuk, that is near the border of Syria. He had to go to different parts of the Arabian desert. So actually, during this whole period of 10 years, the surahs and ayat of Quran which were revealed to him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they are called the Madani surahs. Although all of them were not revealed at Medina properly. Some of them were revealed in different places where he was on journey. But you know, all that part of the Quran, which was revealed during 10 years after Hijrah until his death, this is called the Madani Surahs or the Madani Quran. Now this division between Madani and Makki Surahs of Quran is nearly agreed upon. About most of the Surahs, it is agreed upon whether it is Makki or Madani. But there are slight differences of opinion about a few Surahs and then about a certain ayat also. There are examples that some ayat were revealed at Makkah, but they are included in the Madani surahs. or some ayat were revealed at Medina, but they are included in the Bakki surahs. But as I told you, by and large, it is agreed upon between all the Muslims and scholars that this is a Makki surah and this is a Madani surah. An example of an important exception is Suratul Hajj. According to some people, it is Makki. According to others, it is Madani. And as far as I have been able to understand, part of it is Madani, part of it is Makki. And some ayat, I found it later on, that it was the opinion of Hazrat Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, that some ayat were revealed during the journey that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam undertook during his hijrah, when he was going from Makkah to Medina. During this period, those ayat were revealed. So this surah, so to say, we can call, it is somewhere between Madani and Makki, Suratul Hajj. About the rest of the surahs, as I've told you, nearly there is consensus, there is agreement of opinion about whether they are Makkis or Madanis. Now, fifth point is, who were the addressees of the Quran? Whom Quran addressed? I want to divide this into two parts. The first and foremost addressees of the Quran, they were the pagan Arabs, who were the progeny of Ibrahim and Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam. And Quran gives them the title of Ummiyin, because they didn't have any book. There was no prophet sent to this progeny of Ibrahim after Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam. So these people, you know, they were unlettered one. They had no education, they had no book, no law, no tradition. So they were called Ummiyin. هُوَ الَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُوْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. But secondly, the addressees of the Quran were the Jews and the Christians. So to say, they were the former Muslim Ummah. They were the Ummah of Hazrat Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. They were people of the book. All of them believed in Torah. And the Jews, you know, although they didn't believe in Injil, but they did believe in Torah, in the Old Testament, and all the scriptures of the prophets. So actually they are called Ahlul Kitab, people of the book, and they have been addressed to in the Quran directly, and they were also the direct addressees of the Quran, because many Jews were there in the Arabian Peninsula, and then, you know, Christians were also present in the Arabian Peninsula. To these people, Quran addresses primarily. But secondarily, whole of humanity is the addressee of the Quran. All the people, all human beings who were present in this world at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Quran addressed them also, Ya Yuhannas, O people at large, Ya Bani Adam, O progeny of Adam. So actually, the whole of humanity was being addressed. And not only those people who were present at the time of the advent of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but also all human beings who had to come to this world till the end of this world, till the doomsday. But they are being addressed, and they are the addressees, we may say, they are by proxy. To them this message has to be given and communicated by the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the direct, you know, approach of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he addressed directly himself the pagan Arabs of the Arabian Peninsula and the Jews and the Christians of his time. The rest of the humanity, actually this mission was entrusted to the ummah of the Muslim, of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that now it's your duty to preach and convey and communicate this message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to each and every human being till the end of this world. Therefore, the most important point which I want to make is that when we ponder over Quran and we try to understand it, we should have two levels of understanding of each and every ayah. First of all, we have to keep the ayat or the surahs in the context, the historical context, when they were revealed, to whom they were revealed, who were the first addressees of the Quran, to whom Quran was talking primarily, what were their ideas, what were their beliefs, what were their customs, What were their rituals? Everything has to be in the context, geo-historical context. That we call, in the term of the exegesis of the Quran, Ta'wilul Khas, with the special, you know, perspective of the time when they were revealed, people who were being directly addressed. If we place the ayah or the surah in that context, and then we try to understand what was the meaning of this ayah or surah, which the people understood at that time, at that particular moment in history. And secondly, because this Quran is meant for the whole of humanity, for all times to come. It was not sent only for the Arabs. It was not sent only for the Christians or the Jews of the times of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but the whole humanity. So actually we have to understand the Quran secondarily in a generalized way. That is called the Ta'wilul Aam. Look to the words, what they mean, and just don't keep them bound with the background, historical background. Take it away from that background, and as such, you think over them, ponder over them, dive deep into their meanings, and try to generally infer from it the total and the final and the eternal guidance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided for the humanity at large. Now lastly, the sequence of Quran, Quranic surahs in the Mushaf that we read and recite, and the sequence in which it was revealed, these two are absolutely different. The sequence of revelation and the sequence of the Mushaf, the book that we have, these two sequences are absolutely different. As we know, the Makki surahs, basic principle is that they were revealed at Makkah. They were revealed earlier than the Madani surahs. But we find in the Quran, in Mushaf, that the four Madani surahs, they are in the very beginning of the Mushaf. Suratul Baqarah, Suratul Al Imran, Suratul Nisa, Suratul Maida. Four longest Madani surahs are in the beginning of the Quran, although we know they were revealed after 12 years from the beginning of the Wahi. So the sequence of Mushaf and sequence of revelation, they are different. Now we must understand how Quran was collected and how it was compiled. The collection and compilation of Quran, it was completed in three stages. First of all, the Quran was compiled in a sequence during the lifetime of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam through the divine guidance of Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. Whenever the ayat were revealed, the Prophet said to the people who were writing these ayat, there were certain people, certain companions, who were assigned the duty of writing them, Katibin-e-Wahi, we call them, who used to write those ayat, that put these ayat after such and such ayat of this surah. The sequence was going on as they were revealed, not in the sequence of revelation, but in the sequence of this Mushaf that we have today with us. And this compilation of the Quran was completed in the lifetime of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some people have cast some doubt about it, but actually it's agreed upon, it's absolutely proven fact that the compilation of Quran was complete during the lifetime of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it was done by him. But it was only in the hearts of the people. It was not in the form of a book like this. It was not collected in a book. People had remembered the whole of the Quran, and that was with the sequence. And we know it from very confirmed traditions that in every Ramadan Mubarak this month, Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam used to come and recite the Quran, and along with him, Hazrat Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he also recited in the same sequence. So as Quran was being revealed, the sequence was also being fixed side by side. And in the last Ramadan of the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, the whole recitation of the whole of the Quran was completed twice. So that sequence of the surahs and ayat was completed and compilation was completed in the lifetime of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, although there was no book form of this Quran in the days of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But it was collected in the form of a book within 2 or 3 years after the death of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because we know it. It was done during the caliphate of Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. And his period of caliphate is only 2 years and a few months. So within this period, this was collected in Mushaf also, in a book form also. And then thirdly, during the time of the caliphate of Hazrat Usman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, it was written down in a particular script. And that script we have now, this is called Rasm Usmani. This script was decided by Hazrat Usman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. But only script. Agreed upon script was also prepared. And this was also within a quarter of a century of the death of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because you know, Hazrat Usman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, his period of caliphate is 12 years. Add to it the 12 years of Hazrat Abu Bakr and Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. So actually, before the completion of 1/4 century, after the death of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, an agreed script was also prepared. And now we have the copies of that script all over the world. This is called Ar-Rasmul Usmani radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Now, a few words about the basic terminology about Qur'an. The unit of Qur'an is called ayah. We don't call it a sentence. We don't call it a verse. Some of the writers use this word for Qur'an, but as far as I think, we shouldn't use it. Neither the word sentence nor verse, we have to keep this word ayah. It's very unique. Ayah means a sign or a symbol. Actually, every ayah of Quran is a sign or symbol of the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we cannot substitute any other word in its place. We have to keep it. And because during this translation of the Quran, I'll be keeping this terminology. That is why I'm explaining in the very beginning. Ayat, ayat. But if ayat, you know, if there is full stop after that, we call it ayah. So these are fundamental things, you know. Ayah and ayat is the same. And the plural is ayat. Now, ayat, you know, they are very small also, very large also. We have, you know, haruf muqatta'at. They also go to make ayah. Ha-meem, it is ayah. Alif lam-meem, it is ayah. Then wal-asr, it is ayah. Innal insana lafi khusr, it is again an ayah. And then there are ayat in which you can have 10 sentences. Ayatul Kursi, for example. A very big ayah. One of the biggest ayats of the Quran. So actually, these ayat, you know, they are not based on any grammatical or any other logical, only principle of logic or grammar. This is based on as Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us. And we call it, in this terminology, tawqifi. These umur, these matters are tawqifi. They are mawquf alayh, on the telling of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As he told, we accept it. No reason, no principle, no logic, no grammar. Now these ayat, you know, you may note here, there are about 6,666. There is some difference in number. But round about 6,500 ayat of the Quran, whole. Now these ayat, second term is surah, and the plural is suwar. But you know this word is because it's not commonly used. I'll be using the word surah and surahs during this translation, when translating into English. And what is surah? Surah is not a chapter. Please note, these terms are not applicable to the Quran. These terms which we use about the books generally, sentences, paragraphs, there are no paragraphs in the Quran. Then there are no chapters. This is not chapter. Because you know, for every chapter of a book, there must be a certain topic, and that topic should be discussed in that chapter alone. It shouldn't be repeated in the second chapter or again in the third chapter. But we find in the Quran that even the story of Adam and Iblis, it has been repeated in 7 surahs of the Quran. So actually, it's a unique book. It's not the common book as we know the word book, human books. This is a unique book in itself, and it has its own compilation, its own style, its own terminology. So ayat, then the ayat are joined together in surahs. There are 114 surahs of the Quran. And these surahs, you know, are very small also. Three surahs are there who have only three ayat each. Walas, innal insana lafi khusr, illa allazina amanu wa amilu salihati wa tawasaw bilhaqqi wa tawasaw bisabr. Surah is complete. In the same way, inna aqaynaka al-kawthar, fasalli lirabbika walhar, inna shaniyaka huwa al-abtar. Surah is complete. And on the other hand, we find Surah Al-Baqarah, 286 ayat. And among these 286 ayat, there are certain ayat which are so long that Ayatul Kursi is at least three times bigger than Surah Al-Asr. So actually these sizes are also dependent upon what the Prophet ﷺ told us. These are tawqifi umur, not based on any logic, not based on any principle. The only principle is that the Prophet told us this is Surah Al-Baqarah. Starts from here and here. This is Surah Al Imran. Starts from here and here. It is small or large, big or small. It had nothing to do with any number, any size, any principle of grammar. But as far as the contents are concerned, there are principles. Every surah has a central theme. And all the ayat of that surah, they are connected with that central theme logically. They are absolutely logical relationship. But you know, not as we find in our chapters. It's complete in itself, self-sufficient in itself. Then one point please note, and that is, most of the surahs of the Quran are in pairs. Suratul Baqarah, Suratul Ali Imran, a pair. In the same way, the Mushaf ends with Mu'awwadhatayn. Qul a'udhu bi Rabbil Falaq, Qul a'udhu bi Rabbil Nas. Very similar to each other. That's a pair. In the same way, وَالضُّحَا وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى أَلَمْ نَشْرَحْ لَكَ صَدْرَكَ. The same thing being discussed in both the surahs. Addressing Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم personally. It's a pair. Very apparently a pair. In the same way, يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُزَّمِّلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُدَّسِّرْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُزَّمِّلْ قُمْ إِلَّا 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 قَلِيلًا يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُدَّسِّرْ قُمْ فَأَنْذِرْ. It is again a pair. So most of the surahs of the Quran are in pairs. Although there are surahs which are not in pairs. They are unique. They are munfarid. And most of such surahs are very important. But actually this, we shall be referring to these things during our translation. That is why I want to acquaint you with these basic terminology. Now these surahs, the big surahs have been divided into rukus. This division was not present at the time of the Prophet or during the days of the Sahaba. It was done later on during the Umayyad period and by a person which is not liked by many, and that is Hajjaj ibn Yusuf. He is the person who divided Quran, the bigger surahs of the Quran, into rukus. Why? Because you know you can't recite the whole of Surah Al-Baqarah in one rakat in the prayer. So there must be portions. So you can recite them in your prayers. So for that purpose, one ruku for every rakat. The root is the same. Raka, ruku, rakat, and ruku. All these things, what are? One rakat, you can recite one ruku. So that one subject is discussed in one ruku. So this was done later on, but it was not present in the days of the Prophet or of the companions, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. In the same way, then the whole of the Quran was divided into 30 parts, which we call parat and parts in Quran. This division also was done later on, and we don't know when it was done. But it definitely was not present in the days of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or of the companions. This was to facilitate the Muslims so that every Muslim can read and recite one para, one part of the Quran every day, so that each month he completes one recitation of the whole of the Quran. But these two words, these two terms, rukus and paras or parts, they were introduced later on. They were not present during the days of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or of the companions radiyallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in. But then you know another word which we find in ahadith, that is hizb. The surahs of the Quran, they were grouped in such a way that Quran was divided or divisible into 7 nearly equal parts, not exactly equal. Some hizb is more than 5 paras. First hizb is more than 5 paras. Some is less, because you know, if you divide 30 parts into and you divide into 7, you know, so what will come? About 4.5 in each. But we have somewhere it is 4.25, somewhere it is about 4, somewhere it is more than 5, as I've told you. But the beauty is, and this one was present during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, hizb, because people who had more love for Quran, they used to complete the recitation of the Quran in every week. So they had to divide Quran in 7 parts so that they can complete the recitation of the Quran in 1 week, 7 days. So we find the beauty is that the surahs are complete. They are not broken in this division into ahzab or manzil, as we call it in Urdu generally. Manzil and the ahzab, this is the Arabic word mostly used. We have 3 surahs in the first. If you leave alone Suratul Fatiha, which is the preface of the whole of the Quran, then 3 surahs. Suratul Baqarah, Surah Al-Imran, Suratul Nisa. 1 manzil, 1 hizb. Then 5 in the next, 7 in the next, 9 in the next, 11 in the next, and 13 in the next, and then 65 surahs in the 7th hizb. That is also a multiple of 13. 13 into 5 makes 65. So actually there's a beauty, numerical beauty, as well as, you know, a gradual increase. 3, 5, 7, 9, 11, 13, and then 65. So this was also present, this division of the Quran into 7 ahzab or 7 manazil during the days of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Lastly, there is another grouping of these surahs. And incidentally, this is also in 7 groups. These 7 groups are groups of Makki and Madani surahs. We find in the Quran 1 or 2 Makki surahs, then 1 or more Madani surahs, it becomes 1 group. Then 2 or 3 or 1 or 2 Makki surahs, then some Madani surahs, 2nd group. Then Makki, then Madani, 3rd group. Again Makki, again Madani, 4th group. Again Makki, again Madani, and so on. These are also 7 groups. We find in the first group, Suratul Fatiha is the only surah which is Makki. Only 1. Then 4 longest Madani surahs, Suratul Baqarah, Suratul Al Imran, Suratul Nisa, Suratul Maida, and this goes to make the first group. This is not first manzil, first group of Makki Madani surahs. Then we have 2 surahs which are Makki, Suratul Anam, Suratul Araf. Again, 2 surahs which are Madani, Suratul Anfal, Suratul Tawbah. This is the 2nd group. Then in the 3rd group, we have 14 surahs which are Makki, starting from Suratul Yunus, ending with Suratul Mu'minun, and only 1 surah which is Madani, and that is Suratul Nur. Then 8 surahs which are Makki, again 1 surah which is Madani, Suratul Ahzab, so on. Then again 13 surahs which are Makki, and then 3 surahs, Suratul Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Suratul Fath, Suratul Hujarat, these are the Madani surahs. Then you know, from Suratul Qaf till Suratul Waqiyah, they are the Makki surahs. From Suratul Hadid to Suratul Tahrim, these are the Madani 10 surahs, and this is the 6th group. And finally, you know, it's nearly whole of it is Makki surahs, from Suratul Mulk to Suratul Ikhlas. Only the last 2 Mu'awwazatain, they are the Madani surahs. So these are also, and they are very meaningful. Every group has a central idea, central theme. And the aspects, you know, one aspect of central, that subject is discussed in the Makki surahs. The other aspect of the same subject is discussed in the Madani surahs of the same group. So this is the basic terminology, because it will be repeated time and time again during my translation of the Quran. And when I want to explain what, you know, is the meanings of those ayat and surahs, so this terminology is going to be repeated. That is why I wanted to acquaint you with the basic terminology before we start it. And now we start with Suratul Fatiha. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. This surah, the first point that should be noted is, this is the first complete surah revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Before this surah, there were isolated ayat which were revealed. No complete surah was revealed to Muhammad before Suratul Fatiha. 5 ayat in the beginning of Suratul Alaq. اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. First revelation. Second, the first 7 ayat of Suratul Noon or Suratul Qalam. That is the second surah of 29th part. First 7 ayat. Third, the beginning of Suratul Muzzammil. Fourth, the first 7 ayat again of Suratul Muddassir. And as far as many scholars have the opinion, 5th revelation was Suratul Fatiha. And it was the first surah which was revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam complete. It consists of 7 ayat. This number is agreed, although there is a difference in counting. Some people include surah ayatul bismillah in this counting. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, ayah number 1. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, ayah number 2. And you know they count the last, siratal ladzina anamta alayhim ghayril maghdubi alayhim waladdallin, as 1 ayah. So the total comes to 7. But in the second opinion, and this is the opinion of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, and I also agree with this second opinion. I will let you know the reason of that later on. Ayatul Bismillah is not included in Surat al-Fatiha. This is the opinion of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. This is actually a sign that a surah is beginning. And this is placed between all the surahs of the Quran, except one, you know, Surat al-Tawbah. It has no Ayatul Bismillah in the beginning or before it. Rest 113 surahs of the Quran, before those surahs, this ayah has been written. It's only a sign that the next surah is beginning and the preceding has ended here. That's all. And this is not included, and most of the people don't count it every time. Anyhow, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim is not the ayah of Suratul Fatiha. Surah Fatiha starts with Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahmanir Rahim, second ayah. Maliki Yawmiddin, third ayah. Iyaka Na'budu wa Iyaka Nasta'in, fourth ayah. Ihdina Sirat al-Mustaqim, fifth ayah. Sirat al-Ladhina Anamta Alayhim, separately, ayah number 6. Ghairil Maghdubi Alayhim wa Radhaleen, separately, ayah number 7. This is the second mode of counting. Please note that 7, this is agreed upon, that Suratul Fatiha consists of 7 ayat. But the mode of counting is different. Thirdly, this surah has many names. And it was the custom, you know, with the Arab people. The thing which they liked more, they gave it more names. This surah, because this is a very important surah of the Quran, very basic surah, it has, you know, more than 50 names have been enumerated by Jalaluddin Sayyuti rahimahullah in his very famous book, Al-Itqan, Fi Ulum Al-Quran. But the most important are Al-Fatiha. Why? Fataha Yaftahu means to open something. Miftah means the key, to open the lock. Fataha Yaftahu, to open something. Al-Fatiha, the opening surah of the Quran. So this is actually the name which is most commonly known and commonly used. And this is very meaningful because with this Quran begins, as if it is opening the Quran. The opening surah of the Quran, Al-Fatiha. But you know, Ummul Quran, Asasul Quran, there are so many names. Al-Kafiya, Al-Shafiya. There are, as I've told you, 50 names have been enumerated by Jalaluddin Sayyuti rahimahullah. So these are the different names. Then you know, there is a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, narrated by Hazrat Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. He is an Ansari sahabi. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him the title, Aqra'ul Sahaba, Aqra'uhum Ubay ibn Ka'b. Among my sahaba, the one who is most knowledgeable about Quran is Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. So there is a hadith narrated by him in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has been reported to have said that this is the biggest and this is the most important surah of the Quran. And like this surah, no surah was revealed before it, neither in Torah, nor in Injil, nor in Quran itself. This is unique and this is most profound. So this is actually about its grandeur, importance, its profoundness. This hadith is very important. Then this surah is in the form of a prayer. Although it's Kalamullah, but actually, what is it? It's the prayer taught to us. We address Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala according to this surah. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. We are praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawmiddin. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. Only thee we shall obey and serve. And only thee we ask for help. So actually we are addressing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala according to this surah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught us this dua, this prayer. And that is why this is the real prayer. This is the real salah. That is why the Prophet said, La salata liman lam yaqra bi suratil fatiha, bi fatihatil kitab. Whosoever doesn't recite this suratul fatiha in his prayer, he has no prayers at all. He has not prayed at all. So actually this is an integral part of our prayer. That is why we repeat it in every rak'ah. The full surah is repeated in every rak'ah. So actually, what is the style of this surah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this surah have actually represented the position of a human being whose nature is non-polluted, unpolluted, unperverted, and who has the faculty of right thinking. He can reach by his own thinking and ponderance and meditation, he can reach the conclusion that there is a creator of this universe and he is Rahman and Rahim. And secondly, that we shall have to return to him for the rewards of our actions or punishments of our misdeeds. These things, you know, they are so much simple and so much known, absolutely known and apparent to the human nature that every human being who thinks in a right way, in a straight line, who has the faculty of reasoning in a straight line, who can use his logic in a very straight manner. And number two, his nature is unpolluted, unperverted. He will reach these conclusions. There is some creator. That creator is most benevolent, most compassionate, most merciful. Then he has created us. And he has produced in us a moral law, a moral sense. We know by our nature something is wrong, something is right, something is good, something is bad. When there is this knowledge, this moral law within ourselves, it cannot go unrewarded. There must be some reward. And that reward we don't find in this world. So there should be another life. So these are the basic things to which a human being, if he is good-natured, Salimul Fitra, and if he has the right thinking, he is Salimul Aql, he will reach this conclusion. But now he has to ask for guidance. What should I do? Where should I go? What things are actually harmful for me? I don't know. I want to please you, O Allah. How should I do it? I want to worship you, O my Creator. I want to know you. I want to love you. I want to obey you. I want to please you. But how should I do it? That is actually the, you know, this is the call of the nature. And this call of the nature has been given these wordings by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they have been given to us in the form of Surah Al-Fatiha. Just as we shall find, inshallah, today, in the fourth section of Surah Al-Baqarah, that when Hazrat Adam alayhi salatu wa salam committed a sin, he disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he ate the fruit of the forbidden tree, then there was within him a sense of guilt. He wanted to apologize. He wanted to repent. He wanted to ask Allah for his forgiveness. But he didn't have the words. With which, what words should I ask the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And we find in that section, فَتَلَقَّى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala found in him that he is now feeling guilty, he is now sorrowful, he is now sorry why I committed this mistake. He wants to apologize to me. He wants to ask my forgiveness. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught him the words. فَتَلَقَّى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ. رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. In the same way, if we imagine a person who is right-minded, who is right-natured, good-natured person, who wants to lead a simple and right life, but he wants to know what to do and what not to do. He wants to have the guidance. Now, his ihsasat, his feelings, have been given these wordings by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, maliki yawm al-deen, iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'een, ihdina s-sirat al-mustaqeem, sirat al-lazina anamta alayhim, ghayri al-maghdubi alayhim wa al-dhaaleen. So these are the wordings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the feelings of a man, a good-natured man, who wants to have the guidance. So that is actually the style of this Surah Fatiha. That is why, you know, there is a hadith, very beautiful hadith, in the Sahih of Imam Muslim, rahimahullah, and it has been narrated by Hazrat Abu Huraira, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. This hadith gives us a very beautiful analysis of Surah Al-Fatiha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been reported to have said, قَسَمْتُ الصَّلَاةَ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي نِسْفَيْنِ. I have divided the prayer, that is Surah Al-Fatiha, between myself and my bondsman in two halves. فَنِصْفُهَا لِي وَنِصْفُهَا لِعَبْدِي. Half of the prayer is for me, and the rest of the half is for my bondsman. وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلْ. And I grant for my bondsman what he has asked me. And then there is the detailed, you know, description. When a person says, إِذَا قَالَ الْعَبْدِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ يَقُولُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى حَمِدَنِي عَبْدِي. When, you know, we say, but if we say it from the depths of our hearts, not only repeating the words only, you know, parrot-like, but the actual, our feelings, when we say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, simultaneously Allah says, Habidani Abdi, my bondsman has praised me. Baidha qala al-abd, and when the bondsman says, Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Allah says, Yaqulullahu ta'ala, Isna alayya Abdi, my bondsman has spoken high of me. Then when the abd says, when the bondsman says, Maliki yawmiddin, Yaqulullahu ta'ala, Majjadani abdi, Allah says, my bondsman has glorified me. Now these three ayat are absolutely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the praise of Allah, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, all praise be for Allah, who is the master and the creator and the sustainer of all the worlds. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, he's benevolent, compassionate, merciful. Maliki yawmiddin, and he is the sole authority on the day of judgment, on the day of reward. He is the sole authority. He is the master of the day of judgment. Now this is actually three ayat. They are all for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, praising Allah. Now the fourth ayah, this is actually a bond, a covenant between Allah and the bondsman. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'een. That is why you see these three ayat, first three ayat, according to the Arabic grammar, they go to make one sentence. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim Maliki Yawm Al-Din. Actually, this is one sentence. Although ayat are three, sentence is one. But in the fourth ayah, Iyaka Na'bud, it's a complete sentence. Wa Iyaka Nasta'een, another complete sentence. It is comprised of two sentences. O Allah, only Thee we worship. Only Thee we serve. Only Thee we obey. And we shall translate it into future tense also. Because in Arabic you know fi'l-e muzara. It includes present and future tenses both. Only Thee we worship. And only Thee we shall continue to worship. Only Thee we serve. And only Thee we will continue to serve. Only Thee we obey. And only Thee we will continue to obey. And in the same manner, وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, and only Thee we ask for help. And only Thee we shall ask for help. We shall not ask help. We shall not invoke any other person, any other body. We shall ask help from You and You alone. وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Now this is something in between the two. First three ayat for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is when the bondsman says, according to this hadith, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Hada ma bayna abdi, hada ma bayni wa bayna abdi, wali abdi ma'asal. This is between me and my bondsman. And I have granted for my bondsman what he has asked. What we have asked, Iyaka nasta'een. We want your help. He wants my help, I grant him my help. And then now the last three ayat, and that is why I told you I agree with the opinion of Imam Abu Hanifa that these ayat are three, not two. اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ, guide us on the right path. صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ, sentence is one. These three ayat also go to make one sentence. اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. According to the rules of Arabic grammar, they go to comprise only one sentence. Although the ayat are either two, as enumerated by a certain group, or three, as enumerated by the other people. And I am agreeing with the second opinion. اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ, guide us on the right path. صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ, path of those whom You blessed. غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ, who didn't have Your wrath and Your punishment and who didn't go astray. So actually this is explaining the same thing. اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. And that hadith Qudsi says, when the Abd says this, the bondsman says these words, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ, then Allah says, هَذَا لِعَبْدِي وَلِعَبْدِي مَا صَالِ, this is for my bondsman and I grant to my bondsman what he has asked for. So actually I had, you know, made a diagram of a balance. A balance has, you know, that, what should we call it, a stick. And then, you know, the two sides. And we have three ayat on one side. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawm Al-Din. And then they are attached to that central beam. And with the Iyaka Na'bud. Wa is in the between, where you hold the balance. That is wow. And from wow, the second side of that beam. وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, and with this, you know, we have these three ayat. اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. Very symmetrical, very balanced. قَسَمْتُ الصَّلَاةَ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي نِصْفَيْنِ, I have divided the prayer between myself and my bondsman into two halves. نِصْفُهَا لِي وَنِصْفُهَا لِعَبْدِي, half is for me and half is for my bondsman. Wale abdi masal, and I have granted to my bondsman what he has asked for. And in the end we say Ameen. What does it mean? O Allah, accept our request. O Allah, be it as we have requested You to do. So let it be so as we have requested You to do. So that is actually Ameen. And that is the only difference of opinion is that some people pronounce it with a loud voice. Others, you know, they just pronounce it with a very low voice. But we have to say Ameen. whether jahran or with the ikhfa, but that is agreed upon that we must say it in the end of this Suratul Fatiha. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين والمسلمات.